Hello everyone. In this video, we're going to revisit Archimedes' quadrature of the parabola. I already did a video introducing the main result and one of Archimedes' two solutions, so now we're going to look at the other one. Do check out my other video if you haven't watched it yet, because we'll be reusing some of the ideas that I explained there already. But this is a quick reminder, the claim we're going to prove is that when you slice through a cone to make a parabola and then cut a segment off that parabola, the area cut off is 4/3 of the area of an associated triangle, two of whose corners are the ends of the cut, and then the third corner, you go to the midpoint of the cut and then proceed in parallel to the parabola's axis of symmetry, which for us is always going to be vertically. In the other solution, Archimedes basically filled the parabolic segment with associate triangles in an iterative process. But the method he came up with first is completely different. We actually start by imagining a rod suspended in the middle with weights hung on either side, like a mobile that you might find in a kid's bedroom. So imagine a balance ABC with B in the middle. On the right-hand side, we can make a structure of very light threads to which different shapes can be fixed. And throughout, we imagine that the shapes are made of something like card, which is very thin and uniform, so that the weight is just proportional to the area. Meanwhile, on the left-hand side, we always imagine dangling shapes that we're going to call Z right from the tip at A to make everything balance. And to look ahead briefly, the proof involves some basics about equilibrium, some basics about parabolas, and then some magic that allowed Archimedes to put them together. We'll start with equilibrium. To balance the shapes, we need to equate their areas multiplied by the horizontal distance of their centres of mass from the fulcrum. That's a result Archimedes had derived in one of his other works, Planes in Equilibrium. Then we can say, for example, that the Z that would balance triangle BCD has a third of the area of triangle BCD, because the triangle's centre of mass is 1/3 of the way along from the midpoint of BD to C. So in horizontal terms, it's 1/3 of the way along BC, which is 1/3 of AB as well. For exactly the same reason, the Z that would balance a slightly different triangle, PCD, also has 1/3 of that triangle's area. With other shapes, Archimedes just sets up rough limits, using the fact that the centre of mass lies somewhere within the boundary of each shape. So if we take the last example on the slide, the Z that would balance MFHQ, its area, compared to the area of MFHQ itself, must be the inverse of the ratio between the distances, so between AB and the horizontal distance from B to the centre of mass of MFHQ. Archimedes did know where to find that centre of mass, but he doesn't need to be specific. We can just instantly say that the horizontal distance is somewhere between BE and BG. And for convenience, we can actually express those ratios like BE to AB in terms of the upper side of each shape, which in our case is line PC. So it works out to PM to PC. And we can do the same for all the other shapes. Now for the background that we need about parabolas. A result we saw in my previous video is that if we have a parabola, pick any point A on it, and draw a line through A parallel to the axis of symmetry, which for us is vertical, any chord that's parallel to the tangent at A will have its midpoint on that vertical line. And in any such chord, like BC, we have CM squared over AM being constant. So if we pick some other point D on the parabola and draw DE that's also parallel to BC, then we're going to have MC squared over AM equal to MD squared over AN. Now we're going to gradually develop this result. First, draw vertical lines, lines parallel to the parabola's axis through D and E, and draw in AC, which we'll say meets XD at P and DE at Q. Now, we've got lots of similar triangles suddenly. So ANQ is similar to AMC. So we can say AN to AM is equal to AQ to AC. But we also just saw that AN to AM is equal to ND squared to MC squared. And because ND is equal to MX, we can also use some similar triangles, CAM and CPX, and we see that ND to MC, which is MX to MC, is equal to AP to AC. So overall, AQ to AC is the square of AP to AC. But it's also, more obviously, the product of AP to AC and not itself, but AQ to AP. So when we compare those two equations, we see that AQ to AP must be the same as AP to AC. And when the fractions like this are equal, we can add together the numerators and denominators, and the ratio won't change. So those things are also equal to PQ to PC. But because triangles PQD and PCX are similar, that is also equal to PD to PX. So we've got lots and lots of equations. When we put them all together, the key one for us is that XM to BM turns out to be equal to PD to PX. And if we subtract each of those from 1, we get BX to BM equals XD to XP. And that's true for any D and therefore for any X. It's actually also true of points to the right of M as well, like Y, for example. So this is a nice relationship about where the parabola cuts a line like XP, which runs vertically, so parallel to the axis of symmetry, from a chord to the line through AC. And next, we're going to derive a similar result for where the parabola cuts vertical lines that run all the way to the tangent at C. The first point here is that AM is equal to AL. And Archimedes just took this as a result that was known by previous scholars, but I can just briefly sketch out a proof. For any n other than m, whether it's above it or below it, we would have AN to AM is equal to NE to MC squared, as we've seen. But NE to MC is slightly less than LN to LM, because the parabola is convex, so it's going to lie entirely on the left of the tangent, except where it touches at C itself. So E is to the left of the tangent line, and the triangles formed with L are not quite similar. And with just a little bit of effort, I won't go through the details, that equation can be rearranged to say that AN minus AM and AL squared minus AM times AN have opposite signs. So the right-hand bracket must flip from positive to negative exactly when the first one flips from negative to positive, and that's when n is equal to m. And from that, we get that al squared is equal to am squared, which is what we were after. So armed with that result, we can quite quickly see that px and pz are also the same, similar triangles, and that means that a ratio like xd to xz is just half of the kind of ratios we were looking at before. So it's equal not to bx to bm, but to bx to bc. And again, if you like, you can check that there's nothing special here about x being on the left of m. So we go back to the balance, and at first we don't even think about parabolas. We're just hanging a triangle bcd on the right. In the diagram, b is a little bit below the balance, but it also wouldn't matter if it were on the same level as the balance. Now, as we said, the Z that will balance triangle BCD has a third of its area. What we can do is split BCD into vertical strips and consider the contribution of each strip to that weight that we would have to hang on the left-hand side. And now a parabola is suddenly going to appear. If we take three strips and focus on the middle one as an example, we argued from its centre of mass that its contribution to Z would be somewhere between BE1 over BC and BE2 over BC of the area of the trapezium. And these kinds of ratio are also the ratios at which a parabola will cut a vertical line from a chord to a tangent. So specifically, if we have a parabola with a vertical axis passing through B tangent to CD at C, then that parabola will cut line like EIFI at MI, let's say, and we can specify exactly what those fractions, like BE1 to BC, will look like in our diagram. For example, if we take the first strip, BE1 over BC times that strip would equate to E1M1 over E1F1 of the strip. In other words, it's the trapezium BP1M1E1. So, if we apply this to each of the strips in turn, we can say that the area of BCD over 3, that's the total that you'd have to hang on the left, is between the area above the green line and the area above the red line. And this is true of any set of strips that you can invent, though obviously they would create different zigzags. And you'd imagine that as you split BCD into more and more strips, both the green line and the red line are going to get as close as you like to the parabolic segment. And remember, they're sandwiching BCD over 3. So that value itself must be very, very close to the area of the parabolic segment. Now, as usual, Archimedes has a neat proof by contradiction to show that this is, in fact, the case. Suppose, he says, the area of the parabolic segment is not actually a third of BCD. And then there's some fraction of BD, which we're going to call BG1, such that the triangle BG1C is less than that difference in areas. And then we split BD completely into units of the length BG1, and we make a sort of grid by connecting each of them to C and drawing verticals through points where the parabola cuts those oblique lines. Clearly, the area of each part of the grid in a given column is the same because we divided BD into equal sections. So any of these trapezia is going to be the difference between two triangles where, in each case, the larger elements have the same base and height and the smaller ones also do. So that means that the area of triangle BG1C is one of the elements from each column. And we can shift which elements they are, and that shows that the triangle has the same area as the set of grid elements through which the parabola passes. And now we have that the green area is bigger than the red area. The difference of those two areas, which is the set of grid elements through which the parabola passes, is the area of triangle BG1C. Both the area of the parabolic segment and BCD over 3 lie between those areas, and yet we're claiming that the segment is more than BG1C away from BCD over 3. And that's clearly a contradiction. So since there's a contradiction whenever the area of the parabolic segment is not BCD over 3, we can infer that that is its exact value. To finish off then, we can reason backwards pretty straightforwardly to say that for any parabolic segment, we could create a corresponding triangle BCD. It's not just that a certain class of parabolic segments could be created the way that we've just done. All of them can be. And then we need to show why BCD is itself four times the area of the associate triangle. And this isn't too hard. Remember that M, the third vertex in the associate triangle, is directly below the midpoint of BC. And we saw that that's halfway down to the tangent. EM is a half of EF, and EF, by similar triangles, is a half of BD. So again, we reach that result that the parabolic segment is always four thirds of the area of its associate triangle. Well, this is Archimedes at his most cunning. I particularly like the way the parabola emerges, as if by magic, when you're thinking about balancing a triangle. And near the end, the use of triangle BGC to generate a proof by contradiction is not at all the obvious way to proceed. It's very neat. I want to end this video by quickly looking at a third way of thinking about this problem that Archimedes explains in a later work called On Method. So here we've got a parabola in green with chord AC, and the associate triangle is in red. and we draw the vertical through one end of the chord and the tangent through the other, much like before. But instead of having a horizontal balance, this time we're going to treat CB extended as the balance, and we extend it all the way to C dash so that the midpoint is at O, where it crosses the line AE. And remember, as we saw before, that a line like CB is going to split vertical segments between the chord and the tangent. So O is the middle of EA as well as the middle of CC dash. So now we consider any vertical line across triangle ACE, a line like PR. We know that AP to AC is equal to PQ to PR. We saw that before. And AP to AC, of course, is also equal to OM to OC, which is OM to OC dash. So what this means is if we put a copy of PQ sort of centered on the point C dash, it would balance the line PR across the fulcrum O. And then Archimedes does something which he knew was a bit of a fudge. Imagine doing this for all the vertical lines across triangle ACE in sequence. Then effectively, you would build up a figure congruent to the parabolic segment centered on C dash, and that would balance the whole of triangle ACE, again with the fulcrum at O. Now, since the center of mass of the triangle is a third of the way along OC, we again get that to balance it, the parabolic segment has to be a third of the size of triangle ACE. Now, Archimedes knew that triangles are not really composed of lines, because in Greek geometry, lines by definition have zero width. But he says that this argument gave him a hint and pointed him towards the result, which, as we saw, he then proved by splitting triangle ACE not into lines but into very narrow strips. I hope you've enjoyed the video. If so, do please feel free to share it around, and do explore other videos on the channel which have further beautiful results from ancient Greek mathematics. Thank you very much.